optimization algorithms. The last class we looked at very generic methods, penalty function and augmented Lagrangian, feasible directions. These are very generic approaches. Now let's look at today some very structured algorithm. The one we start with is called linear programming, where every objective function in constraints is a linear function of the variables. Okay. So if you have two variable problem x1 and x2, like it's shown in this particular plot, and you have a constraint in a linear form, that means it will be a11 x1 plus a12 x2 should be less than equal to b1, right? So when you say they are linear, they will be of that form. So in this particular sketch, what I'm showing here is several constraints. So here is one constraint, and this side is feasible. Here is another constraint, and this side is feasible, like that. So you get an overall feasible region, okay, which is shown here shaded. Usually in linear programming, it's assumed that all the variables take non-negative values. So you are always looking at the first quadrant. So these are by default comes in, these two axis and above and right of x2 axis. But then other constraints determine how this will look like. So when you have only linear constraints, you are going to get a convex region, right? It will be a convex region like this. Basically, it's a polygon. It's a region bounded by a polygon. So there will be a lot of corner points that you have, okay? And the inside region, which is feasible. So feasible region is the inside region and these lines, okay, on the points on these constraint boundaries. Now, the objective function is also linear. So what does it mean? So if I now try to make, so objective function can be c1 x1 plus c2 x2. And say you want to minimize or maximize that. So if I want to plot a contour of the linear function, it will look like a straight line like this. It depends on c1 and c2 values, how the slope would be, right? So you have a straight line contour plot of the objective function and a polygonal feasible space. So our sufficiency condition, sufficiency theorem we talked about, gets satisfied because a linear function can be assumed as both convex, concave. So it gets satisfied. So the Kuhn-Tucker point of that problem is going to be the optimum. Okay, so that's just for the side information. But now let's try to look at, if I have a linear constraint objective function and a polygonal shape as the feasible region, can a point inside the feasible space be an optimum?
No, sir.
Why not?
Because we can always take two opposite directions. If along one direction the function decreases, it will certainly increase
in the other direction.
Other direction.
Yeah, so let's take this for example. Okay. So let's say the function value here is 10 of that contour line. That means any two point I take here on this line, the function value will be 10. Okay, that's how they are called a contour line, right? Go down to this line here, which is parallel to that line. It will have a contour line either more than 10 or less than 10, depends on the objective function, the c1, c2 and all that. So let's say this is smaller. So let's say this is 8. Then you expect this to be smaller even, like 6, 4 and 2. So your objective function may be reducing this way. So if you say that here is a point on this line which is optimum, I can immediately argue. So if you're minimizing, I can immediately argue, no, I can find this line which has a smaller function value and then this line which is smaller function value. So that means you can drag the line all the way before it leaves this feasible space. So this will be then the optimum, the minimum. If I'm doing maximization, then I'm going the other direction. Again, this point will not be maximum because this has a higher value than that. And this has a higher value than that. And eventually, this point may become optimum. So it so happens that in linear programming, it's one of the corner point or all the points on a particular constraint boundary here are optimum. This optimum cannot be inside. Is that clear? Is that convincing? Okay, from the geometric point of view? Okay. So now we know in linear programming, it has to be one of the corner points or a segment of the constraint boundary are going to be the optimum points, right? So if that's the case, is there any point for me to search inside? The answer is no. I should not even start from a random point inside like we have been doing and searching within this space, because ultimately I know I have to go to the boundary. Most likely it's one of the corner points. So there are some very smart people early on. They said, if that is so, then why don't we just search along the boundary and not even go inside at all? So I have a much reduced search space, right? Okay, and then I will be able to find the optima very quickly. There are even smarter people. They said, well, most likely corner points happen to be the optima, because it's very unlikely. So when you will have all these points as an optima? When your contour line, yes, contour line of the objective function is parallel to this. That means the objective function is same as one of the constraint functions, but that's very unlikely to happen, that you have an objective function that is same as the constraint function. Usually objectives or constraints are different. So in that situation, one of the corner points have to be the optimum. So then if one of the corner points have to be the optimum, you can now think of a search methodology that will just hop from one corner point to the other corner point to the other corner point, instead of looking at anywhere else. So you don't even look at each and every point on the boundary of that polygon. You can just hop from one corner point to the other corner point. Is that clear? So you see how much reduction in the search space that you are doing by following this principle and by understanding where the optimum can be. So that's why I say this, if you want to study optimization, you have got to have a good knowledge on geometry. You need to be able to visualize some of these things of what's happening. Then you can come up with much smarter and more efficient algorithms. Then the question is, how do I hop? How do I even find one corner point, and instead of going to any other place, I can move to another corner point? So that's the big question, so which we are going to look at with a particular method called simplex search. Okay, so that's the one we're going to concentrate. This was suggested by a person called Danzig a long time ago, okay, around 60s. Then this person is an Indian, Karmarkar, but he was working in US for a long time. 1983, he was working on his PhD thesis, and he figured simplex method is excellent if you have variables that are less than like 100,000, 200,000. Even simplex problems are solved with very, very large number of problems, okay, large number of variables. But he realized if you go to millions and tens of millions or hundreds of millions of variables where the search space is much larger, then there are so many corner points that you are going to have, even that search becomes tedious. Okay, so he thought then you are better off searching through insight. You can find shortcuts through insight to get to the respective optimal point, but you don't get the advantage if you have fewer dimensions, because the number of corner points becomes small in fewer dimensions, so you are better off hopping. So his Karmarkar's method, it deviates from hopping the corner points. It does with what is known as an interior point method. Okay, we are not going to talk about his method because that's very involved, and it only comes relevant if you are doing large number of variables. Okay, so we'll concentrate on the simplex search. So let's continue with the Danzig's method. So Danzig's method assumes that you have only equality constraints. Okay, so for example, you have an objective function that is linear in terms of variables, c1 x1 plus c2 x2 all the way cn xn, where there are n variables, and subject to lots of linear constraints. Okay, obviously, the number of constraints that you have, j, should be much less than n. Otherwise, you have a very restricted search space. Okay, so you don't have too many corner points. Okay, because all of these constraints have to be satisfied. Okay, so so that's one of the assumptions he has. And then xi has to be greater than or equal to 0. Every variable is non-negative. But if you have a negative variable value you are expecting, you have to do a variable transformation to make it non-negative. Okay, so this is the main framework in which Danzig built his algorithm. But that doesn't mean that Danzig's method cannot be applied to inequality constraint. So we'll talk about how to handle inequality constraint, because that's all we are going to have in most problems. I will first start with less than type inequality constraint, because that's a little easier to handle than the greater than type inequality. So all we have are now constraints that, let me go back, that will say this left hand side here, okay, is less than or equal to b1. This left hand side here is less than or equal to b2, and so on and so forth. Is that clear? So we are trying to handle such constraints, less than or equal to type. All right? But Danzig's method requires you to use equality constraints. So first thing he said we do is we convert inequality constraint into an equality constraint. How will you convert?
Introducing some
slack variable. Yes. So what you do is add a variable, a new variable. So if you had 10 variable, n is 10, for the first constraint you introduce the 11th variable, x11. Okay? So because the left hand side has to be less than equal to 0, that means this has to be negative, right? If I add a positive quantity here, the summation will then become 0, right? So by adding a xn plus j variable and ensuring that xn plus j has to be greater than equal to 0, not less than equal to 0, greater than equal to 0, I am ensuring, I am converting the inequality into an equality constraint. Okay. So this is the first thing you do, all less than equal to type you convert to equality type by adding one slack variable per constraint. Is that clear? So if you have j constraints, you are adding j more variables. So you had n variables, now you have n plus j. Okay. I'm calling now, so once you have converted that, you have a situation like this again, right? Everything is now equality constraints. The variables here is not just n, it will be n plus j. And the number of constraints remains the same, is j, but number of variables have become n plus j, right? Okay. So we are having this situation. Now before you proceed with the algorithm, you need to first choose two sets of variables. One is one set you call a basic variable, the remaining variables are called non-basic variables. Let me explain what is the definition of a basic variable. A basic variable is a variable out of all n plus j variables where it has a coefficient of 1 in one of the constraints and it does not appear even once in any of the other constraints. So like this, x1 appears only here with a coefficient of 1 and it does not appear in any other constraints. So x1 is called the basic variable for or representing the constraint, first constraint, constraint number 1. x2 is another basic variable, see its coefficient 1, it is not appearing anywhere else, but this constraint makes this x2 variable as a basic because it does not appear anywhere else. Similarly, x3 for the third and so on and so forth, xj for the jth variable. So there will be exactly j basic variables when you have j constraints, okay, and n minus j other non-basic variables. So this set of constraints that you have to convert into that form, and this is called a row echelon form. Those of you who have done a matrix algebra course are probably familiar with this term because you are taught how to do this. It is basically row manipulation that you have to do. You multiply one of the rows with some number and subtract it from the other column, other row, and you can make that happen. We will take an example and you will see how to make that happen. So once you have made this, each of these variables are called basic, each of these variables are called non-basic. Okay? So this set of equations I have in this slide is exactly the same as this set of equations, except that I have just manipulated them. Okay? But if a solution x1 to xn satisfy all these conditions, it also satisfies all these conditions. So feasibility is intact. All right? But I am just writing it in a different way. Now that I have written the constraints this way, what could be a solution to this set of equations? Because there are j constraints and j is always less than n, I can assume that all these non-basic variables to be 0. I can assume anything here, right? So I can assume all of them to be 0, then what is the value of x1? b1 dash. Value of x2, b2 dash. Value of xj, bj dash. So now I have got a solution which says x1 is b1 dash, x2 is b2 dash, x3 is b3 dash, so on and so forth, xj is bj dash, and all other variables are 0. That is a complete solution, right? That solution is a feasible solution to this system, right? It satisfies all the constraints. That means it also satisfies these constraints because they are the same set of equivalent set of equations. So that means that is a feasible solution. Okay? It so happens that feasible solution is one of the corner points. The way the whole thing is constructed from less than equal to this equal to by adding slack variables makes those solutions as corner points. Only corner points become feasible to that set. Okay? Now that I have got a feasible solution, I can evaluate the function value and see how good it is. All right. Now so I have chosen these j variables, let us say the first j variables at random, and I said, okay, these are my basic variables. Now what I can do, I can replace x2 with maybe xj plus 1. So I can make x2 over there and xj plus, so this xj plus 1 I can make 1 and these are all 0. Now x2 will have some values here. So in that case, I've got x1, x3, up to xj are basic variables, and xj plus 1 is another basic variable, and x2 to xj plus 2 all the way to xn becomes non-basic variable. I can also do that, right? And that will also be another feasible solution, right? So like that, I can take any from here and replace it or exchange with any from this set. So one basic and one non-basic I can replace, and I will get to another corner point. So as many times you do it, you are actually moving from one corner point to the other corner point to the other corner point. Is that clear? So now the question is, when I'm starting with the initial basic feasible solution, which is the next next basic feasible solution I should move to? Okay, so that's what's answered by Danzig in a very nice way. Okay, so this is exactly what I am saying here. Two questions to be answered. First question is, which of the non-basic variables I should make basic? And once I've answered that, then which basic variables have to be made non-basic? These are the two questions. If I can answer, I have an algorithm. Okay, so let me answer that the way that he has done. So obviously there are total j times n minus j options, right? Because one of the ways you can choose the basic variable is j, because there are j of them. Once you've chosen that, there are n minus j variables you have to extend. So there are so many corner points that you are going to have. Okay. Now the first question is answered by maximizing the gain in f. So now you have one of the corner points. You have one of these corner points. Let's say this one. Okay. Now you're deciding where to go, whether to go here, 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 or here. Okay. So Danzig said, I'm going to go to one of those points, which is going to increase my function value the maximum. And he said, instead of jumping around too much, I'm going to only look at my neighboring corner points, only this one and that one. And of them, which one maximizes my function value more? That means the difference between the function value of here and here and here and here, which one is more, I'm going to move to that one. So that way you get a direction towards the maximum point. And remember that in LP we always maximize. Okay? So that's the principle we're going to use to answer the first question. Once the first question is answered, we identify the non-basic variable, then we answer the second question by saying, how much can we increase so that everything stays feasible? So we'll look at one at a time. So let's first answer this question: which non-basic variable to be made basic? Remember, at this instance, when I'm doing it, all non-basic variables are zero. So xj plus 1 to xn are all zero. Okay? Now let's say I am trying xq non-basic variable. It's the qth non-basic variable I'm trying. So now that non-basic variable will become basic, right? When I do it, that means its value is no more going to be zero as soon as you make it basic. So let's say I want to increase it by one unit. It was zero, and I want to make it to 1, how will be the change in the function value? How the function value is going to change? So look at the current solution. Current solution, all basic variables is bi dash. We talked about that, right? X1 is b1 dash, x2 is b2 dash. And all non-basic variables are 0. So what is the function value? Function value is sum of ci xi, c1 x1 plus c2 x2. So these are all 0. So only ci times bi dash for the basic variables we will get. And there are j of them. So this is my current function value. Okay. Now I've chosen xq and made it 1. Okay. Let's see how my function value changes. And now that I made xq equal to 1, so let me go back here. So let's say I have done this one now 1. This is, let's say, q. J is equal to q equal to j plus 1. And I want to make this one basic. So its value will become now 1. So if this is 1, what is the value of x1 now? 0. Say it again. B1 dash minus? Why 1? It's multiplied with A1 dash J plus 1. So this is only 1. So B1 dash minus A1 J plus 1 dash. Agreed? What about X2? B2 dash minus A2 dash J plus 1. Is that right? So if I increase XJ plus 1 from 0 to 1, my basic variables are also changing. Okay? So that's what I have written here. B1 bi dash minus ai dash iq, right? So this becomes my basic variables. Xq is 1. So if I compute, but other non-basic variables are all still 0. So if I compute new function value, it will be c1 times b1 dash minus a1q dash plus c2 times b2 dash minus A2Q dash and all that for all the basic variables plus CQ, because CQ was 0, now it has become 1. So, CQ for the qth variable, whatever is the coefficient. Others are all 0. So, this is my new value. So, if I now take the difference, that means what I am saying is, if I converted xq to be a basic variable, how much will be the gain in my function value? So, f nu minus f old will be the gain, and I am calling that as del f, the difference in f for the qth variable to be made non-basic, to be made basic. It will be, if you take the difference, you will see this gets cancelled. You have CQ minus this quantity, this times this. Okay? So, this, if I take qth xqth variable and make it non-basic, this will be the change in the function value. Now, you can compute for all basic variables, sorry, all non-basic variables one at a time. Q start from j plus 1, then j plus 2 and all of them. And then you can look for which one is going to have the highest value of that. The one having the highest value, that q will be the corresponding non-basic variables, right? Okay? So, this is the philosophy of choosing the non-basic variable, that we look for these, we compute this for all non-basic variables, and the one having the highest value will become the candidate.
So,
yeah.
How can I be sure that this x, that for non-basic variable which we converts value to 1, after that how can I say that the point that is obtained, that is an optimum point?
No, we will say that. So, I was going to get to that. This is what is written here. So, let us say now, it is a good point he is making. How do you know we reach the optimum, right? So, what about, let us say, we are currently at a particular point, corner point, and I have chosen all non-basic variables. For all of them, this turns out to be negative or 0. What does it mean? That means we reached a stage where even if we now exchange with any of the non-basic variables, I am not going to have an increase in my function value. What does it mean? I have reached the optima. So, that is a criteria for stopping the algorithm, when none of the del f q is positive. So, right time you ask the question, because I was going to say that. Yeah.
So,
like,
you just said that we will move to the neighboring point.
Yeah, yeah. I am getting to that. How does this become a neighboring point? Yeah, yeah. So, I'm getting to that. Okay. So, now that we answered this question that we identified the non-basic variables that we have to make basic. The next question is, fine, I've got xq. Now, the question is, how much can we increase? I assume there that I go from 0 to 1. Okay. Now, can we really go to 0 to 1 or can we go more than 1? Because if that is going to improve my function value, I should keep going, right, as much as I can. But what happens as soon as you make xq, remember this was the formula. I mean, here, there I have used xq equal to 1. But now, if I had any xq, I bring back the xq here. Now, I am saying how much can I really increase xq? So, if I go from 0 to 0.1 to 0.2 to 0.3 all the way, you see what is happening to xj? To the basic variables, they are reducing, because as you are increasing this, assuming this is positive, we are actually getting smaller and smaller. Eventually, one of the xj's will become negative or 0. Then if we try to increase that any further, what is going to happen? That variable will become negative, and that is not allowed, because in simplex, in the linear programming, all variables have to be non-negative. So, that is the limit, that how much I can increase xq. So, the limit for the jth variable then becomes, when this is equal to 0, it becomes bj dash over aj dash, a dash jq, right, when this is equal to 0. So, this is the value by which you can increase xq, this value, you can increase xq for the jth basic variable. So, I compute this for all other basic variables, for the same non-basic variable, so, and find out which each of them, we find out this maximum value that we can increase. So, which is the one that we should take? We will not take the minimum of all these values for every basic variable, because that variable will then become negative first, and we do not want any of the variables to become negative. So, we actually take the minimum of this, and that is going to tell me that which of the variables, basic variables, is becoming that for the minimum of that. So, that becomes the basic to be exchanged with the non-basic, right? Okay. So, here is the algorithm again. Choose a basic feasible solution. That means you find a variable that appears only in one of the constraints and not in any other constraint. you need to find j of them like that, and then calculate del fq for all non-basic variables and choose the one having the maximum value, okay, because that's going to increase the function value the maximum. And then if you find that none of them is zero, is positive, strictly positive, that means you have reached the optimum and you quit. And then use, if this is not so, then you use the minimum ratio rule, which is just this rule that we have discussed, for all basic variable and identify which of them has the minimum, and those two should be exchanged, and then you proceed. Okay? So if you are solving minimization problem, there are a couple of ways you can fix it. First thing you could do is multiply f by minus f and then use the above algorithm, or you could do is choose the one having minimum del fq, because now you want to go in the negative direction, right? So you see which one has the most negative value of del fq, because that's going to reduce the function value the maximum, and then your termination criteria has to be changed to saying as soon as you have all of them greater than or equal to 0, then you quit. Okay? So let me take an example to illustrate how this algorithm works. So let's say I've got a function to be maximized. Oops, what happened here? I think this is 3x2. This one is a little crowded here. I have to move this a little bit this side. Okay. Yeah. Do we get it back again? Okay. I shouldn't have done that. Now, how do I take it out? Okay. Got that back. Why can't it move? Okay. So we've got this problem here, 2x1 plus 3x2, we have to maximize, okay, subject to this constraint that x1 is less than equal to 6, x1 plus 2x2 less than equal to 10, and both x1, x2 has to be strictly non-negative, all right. So now, all of them are inequality constraints. So this one in LP we don't consider as constraints. This is all already assumed in the algorithm, right? So you are maximizing. If this was a minimization, you have to first convert it to a maximization problem. Okay. Now, how many variables are there? 2. So n equal to 2. How many constraints? 2. First one, second one. Okay. But now, when first thing we need to do is convert these two constraints into equality constraints. So what I do? I add a slack variable x3 for the first constraint, and I say x1 plus x3 should be 6, and then I add another slack variable to the second constraint x4. You don't put the same variable because there could be a different value here that will sum up to make 10 than here. So x4. Okay? So now both of them are equality constraints. So now how many variables and how many constraints we've got? 4 variable, x1 to x4. And 2 constraints. So j has to be always less than n when you finally convert. Okay. Now, this is called the tabular method or tabulu method, okay, of simplex search. So what you do to make this table is first write down all the variable names here, x1, x2, x3, x4. On top of it, you write their coefficients from the objective function. So coefficient of x1 is 2, coefficient of x2 is 3, coefficient of x3 is 0. Coefficient of x4 is 0. So you write those. This is the coefficient from the objective function. Okay. Now you come this side and write the word basic, because we are going to now declare for every constraint here which is the corresponding basic variable. So for the first constraint, which is the basic variable? x3. Why? Because x3 appears with the coefficient 1 in the first constraint and does not appear in the second constraint. So that's the basic variable for the constraint 1. So that's why I say x3. And immediately what I do, I borrow the coefficient of x3 in the objective function and write it here. So this is copied here. Okay? And then write the constraint with only the coefficients, because the variables are here. So coefficient of x1 is 1, I write it here 1. Coefficient of x2 is 0, I write here 0. x3 is 1, I write here 1. x4 is 0, I write here 0. And then I put a line here and write the right hand side, which is 6 over here. So this one actually represents the first constraint. Is it clear? Now go to the second constraint. Which is the basic variable? x4. Because you see this, x4 is not there. x3 is here, x4 is here with the coefficient 1. So I put x4 here and borrow its coefficient in the objective function, put it here. And then I write the constraints 1, 2, 0, 1, 10. 1, 2, 0, 1, 10. Is that okay? So after I have written that, now the task is to compute del fq. Remember what was, sorry? But it has a coefficient 2. Unity. Yeah. So you could have manipulated, instead of using x4, you could have divided the whole thing by 2, and then it would have been 1 here, and you didn't need x4. But this is a simple two variable problem, you can see everything, but typically simplex problems are solved with these number of variables here could be 100,000, and constraints could be 10,000. So you'll not have a chance to manipulate. You just use whatever it is. So you always add a slack variable, always add a slack variable. Yeah, you can directly take slack variable like the way I've done. Yeah.
But in that case, if you just keep on adding slack variable, will that not like increase complexity?
Yeah, but the algorithm is so efficient, it doesn't increase the complexity that much. Right? So you can close your eyes and add slack variables. No, not a problem. A slightly increase. There is a complexity estimate. But you see, the overall search point is j times n minus j. So if you increase j by 1, you are not increasing the complexity by too much. Okay? So it's kind of j square it goes, but it's not too much.
Is it possible that all the slack variable comes to be a basic variable?
Yes. Usually they are. Usually. At the first time when you are doing this. That's the idea. That first you have only one independent slack variable in every constraint, so that becomes the basic variable to start with. That also you can use? No, in that case, you cannot add a slack variable. There are other methods, like you add a slack variable and you subtract another slack variable. That's called an artificial variable, and you expect those two to be equal. So there are tricks, okay? You just keep on increasing.
Then we can convert into row echelon form and do the same thing.
Yeah, but then I said, you know, if you have 10,000 constraint, doing the row echelon form is not easy, right? Yeah, you can do. You can also. So what he's saying is, first I have all these I put here, and I do a row echelon form with those manipulations. You could do that as well. Okay, but I haven't seen anybody complaining that they are not able to add the slack variables, and you know. So it's easy that every inequality you add a slack variable, and they become the basic variable to start with. All right. Now, before I proceed further, before computing even del fq, let's try to think that this table here, so every table that we'll be using here represents a particular point in my original space. So here is the problem which I forgot to discuss. So here is my x1 axis, here is my x2 axis. First constraint is x1 less than or equal to 6. So on 6 here, I draw a vertical line. Left side is feasible. This is the inclined line, which is that one. And 0, 0, if I take the origin, origin is feasible, that means the left side of this line is feasible. So left side is feasible, left side of this line is feasible, and of course x1, x2 is always non-negative. So I've got this trapezium which is feasible, right? Which is the optimum? Let's try to see, which is the optimum? Now I need to do a contour plot of this objective function. So the way to do that is, you assume some value here. Let's say if I assume a value 6, this has to be equal to 6, then x1 it cuts at 3, and x2 it will cut at 2, and I draw the line. So that's the kind of contour of that contour line of the function, where the one it's cutting at 3 and 2, that will have a function value 6. Then if you increase to 12, it will cut at 6 and 4. So like that it goes. So this one has a value of 28, then 18, then 8. So you see that the function values reduce this way if you go parallel to this contour line. So that means since I'm maximizing, I would like to go as much as possible that way before I leave the feasible space. So which is the optimum? This point, right, is the optimum point. That's the last line, 18. If you try to go any further, you don't have any supporting point from the feasible space. Okay. So now that I know the optimum for this problem, let's see whether this method can get me there. But first of all, where is this point here? See, this figure doesn't have x3, x4. X3, x4 are slack variables. It's not there in the original problem. So this is the original problem. I don't have x3, x4. I only have x1, x2. So what is the value of x1 and x2 in this table? Who can tell me that? Why 0?
Because they're non-basic.
Every non-basic variable, I said, will have a value 0. We assume that. And every basic, so what is the value of x3 in this table? 6. And then value of x4 is 10. But value of x1 is 0, x2 is 0 because they are non-basic. So that means this table represents the point 0, 0. Where is that over here? Origin right here. And that's one of the corner points. Right? One of the corner points. So we are starting from there. Usually, if you take all slack variables as your basic variable, that's what happens. All x's are 0 and you're starting from the origin. Okay. So this represents the origin. Now we have to move to one of the corner points. So how do you do that? Okay, first step is compute del fq. So when you compute del fq, how is this, what is the formula? Is c of this variable, non-basic variable, c minus cb times a. Remember that? I have written it here. C minus cb times a, and we have to go for all the basic variable. This is for summed over all the basic variable. So if you translate this math into a mechanism here, and that's why we do the table, so that I don't have to remember the math, I could still do it, is this minus this times this, minus this times this, whatever is the result you put here. So 2 minus 0 times 1 minus 0 times 1 is going to be 2. 3 minus 0 times 0 minus 0 times 2 is 3. Well, you only have to do this for non-basic variables, and here there are two non-basic variables right here. But usually we continue. We don't keep a track here when you are doing manually, which is basic, non-basic. So we just continue to do 0 minus 0 times this minus 0 times this. But what did you expect here? It will be always 0 because these are basic variables, and you are not taking one of the basic variables in this formula. So it is always going to be 0. But instead of paying attention to which are basic and which are non-basic, you just keep doing all of them. Okay. Now that you have done that, del fq, you notice that one of them will be the highest value. So first notice that, that there are some positive values. That means I have not reached the minima, in this case maxima. I have to continue with the algorithm. If all of them were 0 or negative, I would have stopped. That was the optimum point. But it is not. Then I take the maximum value, which is 3 in this case. The way to do is, so 3 says, if I take x2 and put it here as a basic, I am going to have the largest increase in my function value, not with x1. Okay? So do that, and now put an arrow here saying, this is the x2 I am going to choose here. Now I have to see which of these two basic variables has to be sacrificed. Okay? For that, I have to do the minimum ratio rule. And the minimum ratio rule, remember, was bi dash over corresponding ai. So you come over here, and your bi is 6 for the first basic variable, it is 6 divided by this coefficient. Now that you've got the arrow, we'll be taking these a's. So 6 by 0, infinity, and 10 by 2, 5. So infinity means, okay, if you take x2 as the basic variables, you can keep on increasing it to infinity, it's still not going to make this basic variable negative. Okay? So that's what it means, because it doesn't get affected. So we ignore those things. Anyway, we'll be taking minimum, so infinity will not become the minimum. Now, 10 by, so basically you take the minimum of the two. Now, if any occasions you get negative values here, don't take them, because a negative means you can keep on increasing, you will never get it to become negative. It will always become positive and positive. So don't consider negatives, don't consider infinites. Rest of the thing, you find the minimum. Okay? So you get, in this case, we get 5. So 5 means put an arrow here, and now the two arrows meet here. That means x2 will go here and x4 will come there. Okay. So let's go to the next table and see. So this was the same table I have reproduced, and I said that this is the point A that represents. The usual customary that I do is you write down the solution in terms of original variable, x1, 0, x2, 0, and mark the point on the graph if you're plotting the graph to say which is that point. Okay. Now I move to the next table, now that I've identified. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to replace x4 with x2. And immediately I'm going to bring x2's coefficient here, 3, right? Because I changed this, I have to change this also. Okay. Now I have the same thing. Now I have to do the row echelon on this. Okay. So that means, since I made x2 here, I have to look at the x2's coefficient here should be 1, and it should not appear anything here. It should be 0 here. Now how do I make this 1? Because this is what I have before I get there, right? So I have to make this 1. How do I make it 1? I divide everything by 2, both left-hand side and right-hand side. So this will be 0.5, this should be 1, this should be 0, this should be 0.5, and this should be 10 by 2, 5. Fine? Okay. Now let's go and see if this is 0. This is already 0. So I don't have to do anything else because I wanted 1 and 0 here, it's already there now. So I can bring as it is from here to there. Now you see x2 has a coefficient 1 and 0 here, x3 has a coefficient 1 and 0 here. So they are in row echelon form. Okay? And now I can start looking at del f q and the point first of all. So what is the point? What is the value of x1? It's not one of the basic, so it is 0. What is the value of x2? It's basic. So value, x2's value is 5. So I have got the point 0, 5. Where is that? 0, 5 is this point. Okay? So that means from this point I move to that one. Let's try to look at del f q. It will be 2 minus this times this minus this times this. Now I've got 2 minus 0 minus 1.5. So 2 minus 1.5 is 0.5. Then 3 minus 0 minus 3, 0, and all that you do, we still see that one of them is still positive, right? So we have to take that. So we take this row, so x1 has to come here now. And now we go and see which of the two has to be sacrificed. So I compute 6 by 1, 6, and 5 by 0.5, 10. So out of 6 and 10, 6 is the smallest. So x1 will replace x3. Okay? Let's now take a point and see why did it move to this, why not this? Because this is also one of the neighboring points, right? Why did it move to that one? Let's compute the function. What is the function value here? It is 0 and 5, and the thing is 2 plus 3, right? So the function is 2 times, so it is, so 2 times 0 plus 3 times 5, 15. And if you had moved here, it would be 12. 6, 0, it will be 12. So this has a higher function value, and that's what is denoted by this, and that's why it moves these things. Okay. So now we've got that. Okay. By the way, getting back to your question about why does it move to the neighboring? Okay, you see at every table here, okay, from this to this, how many changes are we making in the basic variable?
One.
So in this case, for example, one of them can enter into the basic. That means both of them are 0. Now one of them has become non-zero. The other still remains as 0. When that happens, you can only move one step. You cannot just move here to there. Because if you move here to there, two of them have to be changed. And we are not doing that. But you can come up with one algorithm as well that you say, I'm going to make multiple moves now, not one. This was simplex. This was Danzig's idea. Okay? But you can change number of them can move here simultaneously. That will be your algorithm. And if you can come up with a very nice way of doing it, you can have a very good algorithm. I'm sure people have thought about it. Maybe they haven't found anything good. But that doesn't mean there is not such an algorithm. So going to the neighbor is not the main thing. Okay, but the way he did it ensures that it goes to the neighbor because one change only happens at a time. But you can jump around in a systematic manner if you want to. And this requires some thought, maybe some analysis and thought. Maybe there's a nice idea somewhere there waiting. And these kinds of algorithms are so popular that if you can come up with a better method than simplex method, immediately you'll be famous. You know, Kormákov were famous just instantly after having that methodology. Okay? It's all about being famous, right? Everything we are doing here. So we get this point B now by this method. Now, have you reached the optimum? Have you reached the maximum?
No.
We still have 0.5 here. Okay, so that means we still haven't reached. We need to go for one more. So what we decided is that x1 will come here. So when x1 comes here, I also have to bring 2 with it over here. And I have to make this one 1. This is already 1. Now, I have to make this one 0. But that's not 0. So how can I make this 0?
Subtract the first row from the second after multiplying the second row by 2.
No. Wait a second. Am I saying it right? No or yes? So which is the pivoting row? You have to see that. Which is the pivoting? Which one you want to make 0? This row. So this is not your pivot row. Your pivot row is the x1 row that we're bringing in. So you have to multiply a number there and then subtract from here. You would get the same answer, but you have to follow an algorithm.
Yes.
And that is that if you had a third constraint, you still do the same thing, that you multiply this by the number which will make this third one 0 here. Okay? So this is the pivot row. So I will multiply this by 0.5 and subtract from here. So 0.5 minus 0.5 times 1, which will be 0 now over there, 0 will be here. And then same thing I do here, 1 minus 0.5 times 0, it will be 1 here. 0 minus 0.5 times 1, it will be minus 0.5 here. And 0.5 minus 0.5 times 0 will be 0.5 here. And 5 minus 0.5 times 6 will be 3 over there. And this is what, I'm sorry, 2 there, 2 there, yeah. So this is what I get here. Okay, now you see x1 is in row echelon form, so is x2. X1 I brought 2 over here, and this remains. Now let's find out which is this point. So what is the value of x1 and x2? X1 is 6, x2 is 2, and that is that point now. Okay, and let's compute del fq. Again, 2 minus 2 times 1 minus 3 times 0, 0, 3 minus that, and all these. Now you see, nobody is positive here. So we have reached the optima. So you'll quit, and we knew that that was the optima, right? So starting from the origin, it follows the quickest path. I won't say quickest, but the one that's going to increase the function value the most. It follows that path by the simplex method and takes you to the maximum point in a very fast manner. So adding another constraint or variable or anything is not a big deal here. It's really very, very quick. So in 3 iterations we get here. Yeah.
Algorithm always lead to the optimal solution, the minimum number of iterations? I mean, it seems quite
weird. With this principle, yes. But as I said, if you change multiple, so if I had the liberty to change both x1, x2, then I could have eliminated this step. I could have had x1 here and x2 there. And that would be just one step I'm going there. But I don't have that algorithm yet. This algorithm, yes. This is going to go in a minimum number of steps. Okay. One change at a time. Okay. I take it back. Actually, it may not be the minimal number of steps, but because if you have, it's still a non-linear function, but I don't know what happens in higher dimensions. Because it could be that if you have a higher dimension, let's say 3 dimensions, in 2 dimensions we have 2 corner points adjacent. If I have 3 dimensions, I can have 3. If n dimensions, I can have many, right? So now this method is going to choose the one that's having the maximum increase in the function value. But that may be far away from where the optimum is, because from there on, there may be very slow changes. But if you have gone the other way, which is not the highest increase, maybe in one step you would have gotten, because the function value changing is such that that gives you a shortcut. So I'm not 100% sure that it takes the minimum number of steps, but it's an algorithm that works, that will eventually take you for sure. Yeah, what was the follow-up question?
Is it like computational complexity of this?
It's j times n minus j, maximum that many points you have to do, right? Any other question? You can have infinite points. Like what if your objective function is identical to the constraint, then any. So it's going to only find one of the corner points. The first corner point it comes across. It will not going to find anything intermediate. This algorithm doesn't have that power. But it is one of the optimum solutions. Any other questions? These are good questions. Okay, so hopefully it's clear, right? How to do, and you'll have an exercise problem to do in the afternoon. Okay, now let's go to greater than equal to constraints. What do we do when you have greater than equal to? Okay, we could do the same thing. We can add a, now we can have a slack variable, now we have to subtract it, because this is supposed to be bigger than 0 or equal to 0. So if I subtract something, it will come down to 0. And make sure x n plus j is also non-negative. But by adding this, like the slack variable when I added, it gave me the initial basic variable as well, right? But by subtracting this, does it give me the initial basic variable? What's the coefficient of this variable?
-1.
But I said it has to be +1, right? So it doesn't give me that freedom. So to make another slack variable, to make a basic variable, what they do, they add another artificial variable. So two variables are introduced to take care of one greater than type inequality constraints, if you want to do it manually, or if you want to do it algorithmically. But the algorithms are such, they don't ask you to do it this way, they just do it internally. But you need to basically add another variable which is a different name. It's not called the slack variable anymore. It's called the artificial variable, because artificial you are adding to get the initial basic feasible solution. And your slack variable is still that same.
Yeah?
No. Why can't we do that? That's a good question again. Why can't we do that? What if we multiply by minus 1? You have to multiply the right hand side. So what happens to B? No, that's what he's saying. Multiply by minus 1, convert it to a less than equal to constraint, and then add a slack variable. But what happens to the B? Become negative. And what did I tell you, that every basic variable takes the value B? So x1 will be minus something, and that's not allowed. Every x1 has to be greater than or equal to 0. So all your B's have to be positive all the time. So you can't do that. Although theoretically you think you can do, but the whole structure of linear programming, the way it works, is such that you can never have B's negative, and that's why you can't do that process. Yeah.
The given condition minus B1 means then we have to multiply by minus 1.
How many times you're going to multiply by minus 1? You did once by minus 1 so that you can handle inequality. Less than to greater than to less than, and now you got a minus 1. If you multiply, then you have changed it to greater than equal to sign again. So you're back to the problem that you have a minus 1 coefficient here, right? Yeah.
So why is it not permitted that the variables have negative values?
That's how the whole thing is designed, right? This minimum basic ratio rule. Well, that's what you're saying, is that we are going to choose an xq such that xj just becomes 0. If you start increasing xq, this is reducing, but as soon as it hits 0, any further increase here is going to make it negative, and we don't allow that. So this is part of the algorithm, that every variable has to be greater than or equal to 0. If you don't allow that, you don't know which basic variable to choose. You have no algorithm. So just to have that, he has to assume that everything is greater than or equal to 0. Okay. And that is also true in solving most practical problems, because x's are dimensions, number of quantities, and so on and so forth. They are never negative. Okay. Any other question? Okay. So let's continue with the dual phase method. So now we've got this additional artificial variable set in addition to slack variable. All of them have to be greater than or equal to 0. That's all right. So now there are two phases you have to use. In the first phase, you try to find a basic initial feasible solution. So what you do, you forget the original objective function that you have to maximize, and you minimize the sum of all the artificial variables so that all artificial variable goes to 0. And then once you get that, you have a basic feasible solution to start with, then you reintroduce the objective function. So these are two phases. Let me explain with an example. So it's the same problem, except that I have now added a greater than equal to constraints. Let me see if I have a sketch. Yeah. So remember this problem, right? Now I've added this new constraint, and I said it's greater than or equal to 0. So 0, 0 is no more feasible. When we do the basic feasible solution, remember we started with 0, 0, but now that's not feasible anymore. So I can't use that. So to find a basic feasible solution, it has to be either this or that. So how do we find that? That is done in the first phase. So let me get back. First phase. Yeah, here. Okay, so do the same thing again. Slack variable for x1 by x3, slack variable of this one by x4, slack variable minus x5 because it's greater than, and then I add artificial variable x6. I made it equal to 2. So everything is equality now. So x6 is the only artificial variable here. So if there are 5 greater than or equal to, there will be 5 artificial variables. Okay. In the first phase, we don't consider our original objective function at all. We say I'm going to minimize x6 or maximize minus x6, the same thing, because LP does maximization. That's why I converted the minimization to maximization. Here coefficients can be negative, it's not a problem, but these cannot be negative, all right? These cannot be negative. So I do that first. If I had another greater than equal to, I would have had x7 or x8. If that was x8, then x6 plus x8 is what I'm going to be minimizing, or minus x6 minus x8 is what I'm going to do. Okay. So now to solve this problem, I go back again. There are 6 variables, 3 constraints. Okay. N equal to 6, J equal to 3, So I write all six variables, they are coefficient in this objective function. See, I'm not considering that anymore in the first phase. So they are all 0 except the x6, which is minus 1. What are the basic variables? x3, x4, and x6, right? So x3, x4, and x6 coming from the respective equations, I write the equations with the right hand side, and then I compute del fq. 0 minus, this times this, minus this times this, minus this times this, 1, and you see that there are two of them having the same value. When this happens, you can choose one at random, okay? So in this case, I may have chosen, which one comes here, x2, I may have chosen that one, yeah, at random. So now you go to this side and do the 6 by 0, 10 by 2, 2 by 1, and I see 2 by 1 is the minimum. So that means x6 will be replaced by x2, and I get it here. All the coefficients come over here, and I now have to make x2 1 here, 0 here, and 0 here. So 1 I've already got, so I can write the whole thing here. In order to make this 0, what I should do now? I should multiply this one by 2 and subtract from the second row. So 1 minus 2 times 1 will be minus 1. 2 minus 2 times 1 will be 0. 0 minus 0. 1 minus 0, so 1. So like that, you do 10 minus 2 times 2, right, be 6. So like that. Third one is already 0 here, so I don't have to do anything. I just bring the whole thing over here, okay? Now compute the del fq. Everything is 0 or negative. So that means I've reached the optimum of this function. Now, that means that I have got a combination of x1 to x5 where there are initial basic feasible solutions. So I can now forget x6 and look at this now. What are the basic variable? x3, x4, x2. So x3 I have 1 and nothing else. x4 I have got 1 and nothing else. x2 I have got 1 and nothing else. Now I have got x2, x3 and x4 as a basic feasible solution. So I can forget this problem and I can get back to my original problem, because I had difficulty getting that to start with to solve this problem. So this first phase helped me get that. So now I don't need x6 anymore. So I will have a problem just up to here, and I have got, so it basically what it did from here to there is manipulated these equations so that x2 has become alone here without appearing in any other two equations. And already I have x3 and x4 from the other two, okay? Is that clear? So now we move to the original problem. So this, I will only keep this much. I will forget x6 now. So here is that same table, okay? And now my objective function has come back, the original objective function. It is no more 0, 0, 0. It's 2 and 3 here. So I do 3 for 2 here. And now recompute del fq, because this is already in row echelon form. I compute del fq, 2 minus 0 times this and this. And now you see there is 1 that is still positive. So I do the minimum ratio rule. I see this x4 has to be replaced with x5. So it goes over there. And I still see that this is 0.5. So I do one more time, and now I see everything is negative or 0, so I've terminated. If you look at what's happening in this tree, in this plot, which point is this? What is x1 and x2? x1 is 0. What is x2? x2 is 2. So I'm starting with this point, 0, 2. Okay? What is x1, x2 here? x1 is still 0. x2 is now 5. So it has moved here now. And what is this table? x1 is 6, x2 is 2, so I've moved here. So started from here. So my first phase allowed me to go from here to there, and then I started with my original function, then I moved from here to there, then there. Okay? So because of the addition of these constraints, I had an additional step. So when you have greater than equal to constraints, it's a bit more complex to solve the LP problem. If all are less than equal to, you have an initial starting point, and it's a little quicker. So x6 was artificiality. Right? I had to add x6 because I don't have a starting initial basic feasible solution, right? So I said, okay, I know that x6 has to be greater than or equal to 0. Now if I say I want to minimize x6, and x6 has a constraint, x is greater than or equal to 0. So what is the minimum value that you can expect? It's a variable that you want to minimize, but it has to be greater than or equal to 0. So what is the value that you can get? 0. So as soon as I get a value of x6 equal to 0, it's as if saying you don't need x6 because its value is 0. So I can take it out because it's appearing only here. I can take it out. But I did not have that in the initial basic feasible. So I'm using a LP to give me that solution for which x6 is 0. So here it converged means I've got the optima of this problem, and optima of this problem I know when x is equal to 0. So now that I've got the x6 0, I don't need it anymore. And I can now take the remaining ones and start my original problem. Okay? Yeah, it's only used to find the initial basic feasible solution, like this solution here, which I could not find from my equations. If I manipulate, I can do, but as I said, when you have 10,000 constraints, you will not be able to manipulate and get that. You need such an algorithm to give you that initial starting point. No, you're just, we're just changing the objective function in the first phase, which is maximizing minus of sum of all the artificial variables. Once we get the optimum of that, we know each and every artificial variable has gone to 0 now. So I can start my original function. So we take out that objective function and put the new objective function and continue from there. Okay? Any other question? All right. So I think it's a time to give a break, tea break, and then we'll start after coming back. 5 minutes, okay?
Other this Bessel 1 or 0, 0 mostly. I'm forgetting the.
Okay, so you have not understood anything I said, because the definition of the basic variable is that it has to be 1,
okay,
and rest all has to be 0. Otherwise, it's
okay.
Not a basic variable.
Okay, it has to be 0. Okay.
Has to be 0. That is the definition. Okay.
So one thing here we have added and we have subtracted if x 5 where is the. We have subtracted x5 to make it less than?
To make it equal to 0. Because this one has to be greater than equal to 2, right? So if I subtract something from it, then only it will become equal to 2.
Then it will be equal
to. So that's why I have subtracted x5 and made sure x5 is positive or 0.
Okay.
But then in doing so, I cannot say x5 is a basic variable because its coefficient is minus 1. I need a plus 1. So I don't have a basic feasible solution. That's why I'm adding another artificial variable, so that I have a basic feasible solution.
This is as it is plus 1?
Yes.
So we are that's assuming
right.
It as.
Yeah. So we are always adding this. So it immediately gives me 1 as the coefficient. But I don't want x6. So that's why I do this initial step phase 1 here to find a solution for which x6 will turn out to be 0. Well, as soon as I get x6 equal to 0, I just remove it. Yeah.
I was actually trying to improve this algorithm.
Mm-hmm.
So what I thought said, it actually what this does actually print, so this is actually g1 x plus 1 minus square minus gx square.
No, you want to do square here. The way it is done is not square individually. You get the bracket value of that and then square it.
I was thinking to use an exponential function instead, because if you look at the graph,
for what?
The higher values.
Which is the exponential?
For this function.
Uh-huh.
I was thinking to use the sum of squared error of the of this value, like g x
okay.
plus 1 minus g x square.
Mm-hmm.
So if you see the exponential function at higher values, it will have high value will exponentially increase, but whereas low value, the value.
So what is over here? You have x-axis.
Yes, sir. X-axis.
What is the x? Is it x or gx?
Say this This will be this whole term. Gx plus 1
oh,
minus
Gx. The x axis is the whole term.
Yes, sir.
Difference.
Yes, sir. Mm, because
I don't know what's that going
that
to achieve.
You told me that.
So here is 0.
Yes, sir.
So do you want gx to be more than gx or less than gx? So this one's when gx plus
because
1 is more.
When we reach gx plus 1, we are actually violating the constant less. I mean, we are, as you told me, no, in this figure.
Yeah,
we
yeah.
We are improving the value.
Yeah, you are reducing the value.
Reducing the value.
Yeah.
So this whole term will decrease as we do more iterations. So this will come down.
Okay. So this is not this method you are saying. You are talking about improving this method, penalty function
yes.
method.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Not
yes, sir.
Not the augmented Lagrangian
yes,
method. Yeah, you could do. You could do various things. You could have. You don't need this just straight line. You could do exponential. You could do polynomial.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You could do. But I think the whole philosophy still remains the same. You still need to adjust the R. That is the problem with this method.
Yes, sir, what if you use different R values for different constraints?
Yeah, you can use, but then you have more parameters to update.
Parameters.
To avoid that.